Coming up, we discuss cybersecurity based on the work of the Microsoft Threat Intelligence Center, how this applies to Azure and the global security landscape. We'll make this real and cover the work of the intelligence team to protect against initial attack vectors that can lead to broader exploits, starting with the OS layer with brute force attacks against RDP or SSH, the app layer and SQL brute force attacks, and how we learn from malicious activities across Microsoft services to enhance protections in Azure. I'm joined today by Shain Wray from Microsoft's Threat Intelligence Center. Welcome.
Thanks, Matt. Great to be here.
So what specifically does your team work on, and where does that fit in the broader scope of what Microsoft does in the security and cyberspace?
Yeah, at Microsoft, we have thousands of experts on different groups across Microsoft globally that are working on security issues. We're one of those teams that counters threats across the security landscape, all the way from potentially unwanted software to ransomware attacks, all the way through to hacker groups and nation-state groups. And we use threat intel, we use proactive hunting and reactive investigations to work on this. We also have a dev team that engineers ways that we can better detect adversary activity and investigate and respond to attacks.
So can you give us an example of the tools and processes that you might use to detect and respond to the events?
Yeah, absolutely. So similar to Azure Log Analytics that any tenant can have, we go in and we do a raw data check against all of our alert information so that we can build out a better picture and understand the attack. I'm going to go ahead and show you what we do here. So as you can see, I'm in Azure Security Center, and I clicked in the Azure Log Analytics, and I open up the security event. I got a canned query here, and this is just an example. I've got a time generation date in there, but you can also set it next to the Run button. I'll go ahead and click the Run button, and once you can see the results up here, it'll be interesting. You'll see that we've got a random name process as the third process listed there. It's running out of the temp directory, and in this case, what I could do is I could go ahead and expand, and I could add in that time generated as a scoping command. And then from that perspective, it allows us to understand the scope of the detection and and what's happening around it. And then the only real difference for this is related to what we can do and what the tenant can do is we just have an aggregated view for multi-tenants, and we can query across them and see all the stuff that's occurring around this time.
Right, so you are using Log Analytics and other tools to detect anomalous activity.
Yeah, not only that, we use Log Analytics to improve the details and improve the remediation steps in the given alerts. And this helps to better inform the customers, and it helps harden everyone's security posture in Azure.
Now, there's also an aspect of working broadly within the industry to understand unknown attacks.
Yeah, we build threat intel across unknown attacks, and this is based on adversaries and actors and in various regions and industry through security signals that we have inside of Microsoft and industry intelligence that we gain. We also share this non-PII data with a lot of our fellow security investigators. We share about the attacks. They do analysis. We do analysis. We go back and forth between the companies. And what this helps us do is it builds a better picture of the attack sequence. And then we can help protect customers better, not just Microsoft customers, but all customers. The one thing to be aware of is we never disclose any specific enterprise, customer, or personal information. And some really good examples of cross-company collaboration have been on WannaCry and Petya, not Petya. Also, the vuln discovery work that we did on Spectre and Meltdown have been great.
So your team's analyzing the approaches and the methods used in the attacks, but how does that work then feed back into Microsoft products and services?
Yeah, so we have a broad view of cross geographies and industries, and this helps us to see attack patterns that occur across them. This is in relation to network and services and applications and operating system level details, right? And as soon as we identify an attack, we work with Microsoft teams internally to build mitigations. And this helps us understand what attacks are occurring across geographies, and potentially to help us understand if an industry is going to be attacked, we can notify that industry.
Great. So can we take a look?
Yeah, absolutely. So what you can see on the screen here is a heat map of potential attacks. And what we do is this is related to our alerts and what we think attacks may happen. I click on the malicious SQL activity alert here. And you can see in the heat map clearly in Southern Asia that we've got a high count there. If I go ahead and hover over that, we can see details about this, you know, the industry and the process names and the account SQL server being used. And additionally, you can see other processes that are associated with this. And that association just helps us identify and potentially look at other detections. So if I click on the region, then we can see what other alerts are firing in that region. And that potentially helps us understand the attack sequences that occurred. We had the malicious SQL attack. We had the SSH command attack. And then if I click back on MySQL, I can look at regions and I can see across regions what's being attacked. Well, here we can see ping and we can see MSSQL server. And again, we see the same domain, right? That domain is, you know, it looks to be a domain in Portugal. It looks like a random domain that's created. And based on that, we could go look at further look at the industries. And we could say, all right, what industries are impacted by this also? And across the industries, then we understand better, right, about this industry is impacted. It's impacted with these items. And from that point, we would go ahead and let industry leaders know or what's going on with that. So from that data, we build into the new threat intel reports, the what happened, how the attack occurred, when, you know, where did it occur. And we also provide remediations inside of that. And additionally, we've gone in and developed improved methods in ASC within the investigation path to help you to show you exactly what's occurring. So I clicked into the Azure Security Center here, and this is the investigation path portal. And I can click into a username, and I can click into a machine. And additionally, on that machine, I can go ahead and click right on through to the different alerts that are associated to that. Now, this is associated to that machine, but what's interesting is I pivoted in from a specific user. And as I click into the alert, I get more details on those alerts.
Cool. So can you give us an example of some of the attack types that you've seen and how you've worked with the product teams to stop them?
Yeah, in Azure, we see plenty of remote desktop protocol attacks and SSH attacks where the adversary uses brute force on a VM with remoting enabled, typically over port 3389 or 22. They'll try common passwords until gaining access. And from there, they can either profit from the compute of the machine or use this network access to perform lateral attacks or recon on other networks. And the thing about this is that if you're used to on-prem system security, you should be familiar with this. And the same security hardening guidance that you use for on-prem, you definitely need to be using it in the cloud.
And it's important to note that there are many security configurations that can open the attack surface for attackers. So how do you help with that?
Yeah, for sure. So as a result of our work, there's features that we put in relation to prevention in the Azure Security Center, specifically in the resource security hygiene. And if we take a look at this, you can see, I'll click into the Azure Security Center again here, and we go into recommendations under resource security hygiene. I'd go ahead and click through remediate security configurations. And these are mitigations that you'd want to be aware of in relation to the operating system or whatever you have in your environment. And this helps prevent the attack originally that would trigger the alert. And you can see details here about file permissions and setting in 640 and stuff like that. And my recommendation is you check this often, because if you don't check it often, there's going to be information in there that you need.
Okay, so what kind of things would an attacker do to profit from that machine?
Yeah, two of the most common uses are to hijack that system, then to either use it as a sender of spam, usually with the intent of delivering a malicious payload. Additionally, we've seen many systems get used as zombie Bitcoin miners lately. And the other thing about it is the reason I mentioned spam, and you kind of might wonder why I'm doing that, is we have a great product called Office 365 Advanced Threat Protection. And this protects you against links and attachments that are malicious. So definitely want to look into that. The other thing that we do is we share our investigation details with Microsoft teams, all the security teams of Microsoft, we share this information. And effectively what that does is allows us to use the cloud to protect itself.
Right. So if you're using a virtual machine in the cloud or on-prem, you're going to need to access those machines remotely somehow. So how can you ensure that only the authorized virtual machine owner's requests make it through to that VM?
Yeah, so through our work, you know, I mean, we basically understand that admins have to connect and they've got to work to configure and troubleshoot their VMs, and they got to have a way to do that. So we worked with the Azure team to help reduce the attack surface, and more specifically, from the connection perspective, we looked at the time ranges and IP limitations that you could do with a given connection. In this case, we came up with just-in-time controls. And I'll click into the Azure Security Center here again, and you'll see under Advanced Cloud Defense, just-in-time VM access. I'll go ahead and click into recommendations, and I'll choose my own virtual machine. And this, I'll go ahead and enable it. You can see that there's ports already configured here by default. I'll click Add. You can add any port you want if you change the listening port. I'll put port 2222 in here. I'll add my own IP address in here, and then I'll give it a time. I'll click OK. The one thing to be mindful of here is make sure you click Save. Even though it shows up, it's not necessarily saved for that VM. So then it'll default back into the view for recommendations. Click on Configured. At that point, I can select my VM, and I can go choose to request access for this. Once I do that, I want to choose the port I want access on. In this case, I'll do 3389. It's a Windows VM. I go ahead and click open ports. And at that point, I've got access and I can connect into it.
Right, so to clarify for people, unless you're accessing this VM from your public IP address, your IP on your machine, mm-hmm. within a specific time window, you can't access it.
Oh yeah, the first question I get is, what if my admin creds are popped? How do I know that I'm protected? Well, you should be using multi-factor authentication. That's easily configurable inside the Azure portal.
Okay, so those are classic but still frequently seen OS level attacks. But what about the application level? What types of attacks are we seeing here?
Yeah, it's very similar. You see the RDP brute forces. In this case, SQL brute force is one of the top items. SQL brute force is an interesting thing. It usually requires a SA account to be enabled. This is something that the generally administrators don't do, but on occasion, they'll go and enable it to do some function on SQL and then forget to disable it. Well, SQL listens on a network port, and if that network port is not either IP limited or turned off from public interface, then you potentially could get hit, especially if that account is enabled. So what they do, the attacker does, is they'll port scan all of the ports in Azure and anything that's listening publicly. They easily identify that it's a SQL port that they found. And even if you change the port, they're still going to be able to discover that. And then they'll go ahead and go through a brute force process of the password. And once they gain access, they're almost guaranteed to be able to gain access, especially because people use pretty weak passwords for SA accounts. Then they'll go ahead and turn on the XP command shell stored procedure. At that point, they have a command shell on your host system, and now they can run any code you want.
So how do we help with this?
Yeah, so we through our investigation process, we worked with the SQL Threat Detection team. The SQL Threat Detection team has mitigations and preventions built into Azure PaaS instances, but what they didn't have initially was IaaS-based instances. And so that's being expanded into the IaaS-based instances. And the good example of this is the SQL Threat Detection view. The other thing is we have guidance around the whole SQL brute force attacks in blogs that my team has written. And specifically, the mitigations are pretty simple. Just disable the SA account, make sure that it is disabled regularly. I would change the SA account name to something else. Harden the password for sure. Don't use some simple password easy for you to remember. Disable the public interface or make sure you absolutely restrict the IP range. And regularly check for XP command shell, the stored procedure is disabled.
Okay, good advice. Now, how do you go about investigating attacks in general and providing alerts for customers based on your team's research?
Yeah, so let's go back into log analytics here. And I can give an example of what we do. I have a hunting query that I've pasted in here, and I'll go ahead and run it. And what this hunting query does is it allows me to see rare processes that are running in a given environment. So you can see here, I can see rare processes. These run rarely. I see PSExec, which is definitely interesting. And we see Tomcat run right after that from a temp directory. So that's interesting. Tomcat's normal, but not from that directory. Mm. So I would add in that scope for the time, but I've already created a query here for speed. I go ahead and run that. And based on that time frame, and including PSExec and Tomcat, I can see all the things that were run. You can see test user was run here. And you can actually see Tomcat was also run, right? And so I'd also look at this a little further. I'd scroll down. I'd see, okay, we can see test user used a bunch. We can also see initially Tomcat. They were trying to do something initially with Tomcat. At this point, I would take the earliest date, and I would take the latest date. So I'll go ahead and add those in here to show you the same way that we would do it normally. I do have a pre-canned query that we'd run on this. But just be mindful that you need to scope these queries as you broaden them, because what you're doing here is you're going to increase the amount of data returned. So let me go ahead and run this query. Okay, so now what we can see is based on the time range and broadening out the scope, we can see WinLogon running, we can see RDP clip running, and these are all in time with when those processes were running. Mm. I can also see I need my password reset, which is not very good. But in that case, what that tells me is there was an interactive logon that occurred. And because there was an interactive logon that occurred, I'll later want to probably look at the logon data. Before we do that, I would actually want to see what occurred even before this. So I would broaden the scope of the time out further and go ahead and run that command. And what I can see here is as I look through the processes, these are all the ones we saw before. We see RDP clip and more Tomcat. But what's more interesting is we now see run DLL running from a temp directory. And beyond that, we also see conhost running from a fonts directory. So these are very abnormal, right? The date's back on 5/22. Let's go see if there's any logons. Maybe this is a brute force. Let me look at failed logons first. I got no results for failed logons, so I just look at the regular logons. And these are successful. So these are all the same accounts we saw before. Test user definitely logged onto this box and was interactively working on the system. And what we don't see is anything before that. We see Contoso admin. So I would think that the admin account is potentially compromised at this point. So, you know, at this point, we go and we find this new information and we add it into the detections and we broaden the impact of that alert for a customer. We go and share the findings with our teams across Microsoft. This helps improve our security posture across Azure and helps the detections across all of our products.
Great stuff. Well, thank you, Shane. That was an awesome walkthrough of the work that you and your team do to keep everybody safe. But how can people put the intelligence, the insights, and the mitigations that your team provides to work for them?
Yeah, for sure. They need to make sure they go in and follow the configuration-based recommendations that we have and the prevention mechanism. Additionally, I mean, I think the piece that was the most important out of this is we have built-in investigation tools in log analytics, and you can really use this to understand impact across your environment. Additionally, if you're not sure what queries to run or you need help, there's blogs out there with many examples for you to go refer to and look at. And last but not least, but refer back to ASC dashboard all the time. There's broad, centralized, real-time information there that can help you with alerts and investigation processes.
Awesome. Shane, thank you for joining us on the show. And of course, keep checking back on Microsoft Mechanics for the latest in tech updates. Thanks for watching.